Mutations. They refer to changes or variations which occur in the members of a population. But these changes are not gradual, but they appear suddenly or they are abrupt and they are discrete and discontinuous. So, these are the sudden and discrete and discontinuous variations which appear in populations. The term mutations was coined by Hugo de Vries in 1901 based on his studies on the plant evening primrose or Oenothera lamarckiana. So, in his studies, he could observe different varieties of the plant which differed from the normal wild variety. He could see a taller variety which is called as Oenothera gigas. Then he found Oenothera nanella, which was a dwarf variety, and Oenothera lata, which is a broad-leaved variety. And de Vries believed that these different varieties could have emerged by sudden changes in the wild variety. And thereafter, he proposed the mutation theory of evolution, which states that evolution is not a gradual process, but it results from abrupt, discrete, and discontinuous changes in existing species. Now we will check the different types of variations in organisms. So this is a population where we can see variations in the morphology, and here are all examples of variations which we see in different populations. So there are many reasons for variation. Usually, according to the Mendelian principles, variations occur in populations gradually by crossing over, recombination, allelic segregation, etc. So these are the normal mechanisms by which variations appear in sexually reproducing organisms. How do mutations contribute? They are sudden and abrupt changes which occur in populations, but they are heritable. A change that has occurred suddenly and abruptly in a population is transferable to the next generation. And there are no intermediate stages in between. They arise from changes in genotypes which finally lead to variable phenotypes. And the first recorded example of mutation was in 1791 by a farmer Seth Wright, who found an Ancon breed of sheep in which he could see short-legged sheep. So this is the normal sheep, this is the normal ewe, and this is the mutant ewe. So this can be considered as the first recorded example of mutation. We come to the salient features of natural mutations. They are spontaneous. That means they appear by their own. The environmental factors cannot initiate mutation because mutations are initiated always in the genetic makeup of organisms. So, environmental factors cannot initiate them, but they can influence the frequency of mutations. Mostly, mutations are harmful, but there are some which are favorable. What are neutral mutations? There are some which will not give either a selective advantage or a disadvantage to an organism. They can be considered to be neutral mutations. And this process is quite random. The time of appearance of mutation or the location of appearance of mutation, that means the in which chromosomal locus can mutation occur, during which stage of cell cycle can mutation occur. This is a quite random process. There is no fixed time or location. This shows persistence. That means once a mutation appears in a population, it will be inherited by several successive generations without considerable changes. But we cannot consider these changes to be permanent. Now, they are transmissible to generations. They have low frequency rates. The genes can be classified into three types based on the mutability. Mutable genes are showing high frequency mutations. Mutated genes are those who can accelerate the mutations of other genes. Anti-mutated genes are genes who can inhibit mutations in other genes. Now, the chromosomal loci, which are also called as hotspots. What is meant by a hotspot? Those sites or loci on chromosomes which show high frequencies of mutations are called as mutation hotspots. Now, the mutations can be classified as forward and backward. In a forward mutation, a wild type allele will be converted to a mutant allele. That is, a wild type character will be converted to a mutant character. In backward mutation, a mutant character will get again mutated to reconvert it into the wild character. So when it is converted from wild to mutant, then it is called forward mutation. And if a mutation occurs in such a way that a mutant character reverts to wild type, it is called as backward mutation. More frequent are the forward mutations. The mutant alleles are pleiotropic. That means the mutation can lead to many phenotypic effects which may be unrelated, like the disease phenylketonuria. That will lead to a number of changes in the organism that inherits the character. Most of the mutant alleles are recessive. Compared to the wild type allele, most of them will be recessive and the normal alleles will be usually dominant. But there are some examples, that is the achondroplasia allele, which leads to a particular disease called as achondroplasia, in which there will be large head with prominent forehead, but the short arms and the legs and arms will be short. So in that case, it is dominant. It will overpower the normal allele. The epiloia gene in humans, which is also considered to be a lethal gene, that is also dominant compared to the normal allele. But usually most of the mutant alleles will be recessive in comparison to the normal allele. What is the role of mutations in speciation? Speciation means it is the evolution of a new species. And for speciation, variations become the basis, because you can imagine a population with a number of organisms having variations in characteristics. And if an environmental change suddenly appears, those individuals who are having characteristics or variations which gives them adaptive value in that particular environment will be selected by nature. So natural selection picks up those variations which are well adapted to that particular environmental change. And finally, they will evolve into a new species. So that is the basis for speciation. So variations form the ultimate mechanism or the ultimate basis of speciation. So mutations are the ultimate source of genetic variation, which in turn is the ultimate mechanism of speciation. If the mutations are beneficial, they will allow the organism to survive and reproduce better than other members of its species. But a mutation that may be beneficial in some circumstances can be harmful in others, but we will just leave it. There are some mutations which are beneficial and they allow the organism to survive and reproduce better than other members of that particular species. The mutations become important when an organism's environment is changing, because if the mutation leads to a variation which is favorable for that particular environment, those organisms showing the mutation will be showing adaptiveness, fitness, and survival value. And natural selection increases the frequency of favorable mutations in a population. And the accumulation of such desirable mutations over millions of generations will result in speciation. Mutations also bring new alleles and allelic combinations into the population, thereby increasing the evolutionary potentiality, because when new alleles and allelic combinations are brought into the population, there will be more scope for variations, and variations form the basis for speciation. And if there are more variations in a population, the evolutionary potentiality of that population is higher. Now we will go to certain characteristic mutations that have occurred in the human population, certain notable mutations. The examples are the presence of blue eye, red hair, cystic fibrosis, etc. Cystic fibrosis is a disorder. So these are traits which occur only in certain populations of humans, whereas most of the other traits are shared by all the people. So they must have arisen long ago, but those traits which occur only in certain populations must have arisen out of mutations. So these are some examples, and we go to the case of cystic fibrosis, which is a disorder that is affecting the lung. And it is most common in people of Northern European descent. Then sickle cell anemia, which is characteristic of sickled RBCs, and that is endemic in African and Mediterranean people. And the Tay-Sachs disease, it is more common in Jewish people whose ancestors came from Eastern Europe. So these are some of the traits that occur in certain limited populations, and they are all examples of mutations. Here, see how a beneficial mutation is transmitted over successive generations and how it has increased the survival value and reproductive fitness of humans That is the development of opposable thumb. This has been a mutation because this is a feature seen in only limited species of mammals, so primates. So because of this, even though it has arisen out of a mutation, it has given greater advantages for humans than other animals belonging to the same taxonomic category or same order. Here are some examples of harmful and beneficial mutations where we can see some mutations have led to morphological deformities that will reduce their reproductive fitness and survival value. These are some beneficial mutations which give camouflage, or they are concealed in their respective environments. You can see an amphibian which is adapting to the appearance of its environment. And here there is a reptile who is adapted to its environment through camouflage. So they are all beneficial mutations, whereas these are harmful mutations. The classical example of a harmful mutation is that of sickle cell anemia. This is actually a disorder that leads to the sickling of RBCs. It's a gene mutation. So this gene has got two alleles. HBA is the normal allele and HBS is the mutant allele. If a person is homozygous, that is HBA, HBA, he will be a normal individual. If he is HBS, HBS, he will be sickle cell anemic. That means the hemoglobin formed will be defective and the RBCs will be sickle shaped and they will no more be able to transport enough quantities of oxygen, and that is a fatal condition. But what about the heterozygous individuals who are having the allelic combination HBA, HBS? In them, some of the RBCs, a proportion of the RBCs will be normal and the rest will be sickle shaped. So here, when we correlate it to another characteristic, that is, we will take another disease that is infecting humans, which is called malaria, which is caused by a protozoan known as Plasmodium, and which resides and reproduces inside the RBCs of humans. In persons who are carriers or persons who are heterozygous for sickle cell anemia, they will be having normal as well as sickled RBCs. And this Plasmodium cannot survive and reproduce in the sickled RBCs. So this makes the carriers more resistant to malaria than the normal individuals who are normal for the sickle cell gene, for the hemoglobin gene. So normal individuals are more prone to malaria because all their RBCs are normal shape and they provide a facilitating environment for the growth and reproduction of Plasmodium. Whereas the carriers, in them, and the environment is not congenial for the reproduction of Plasmodium, so they are having a higher survival value against malaria, in the case of malaria infection. So 1/3 of all the indigenous inhabitants of the sub-Saharan Africa, they carry this particular allele, and it is in this region where malaria is common, and they have a survival value in carrying only a single sickle cell gene. But unfortunately, those who are homozygous for the sickle cell allele, that is HBS, HBS, it will be lethal to them because all their RBCs are sickle shaped, which will lead to impaired oxygen transporting ability of RBCs. Mutations can be classified into different types depending upon various criteria. They can be either somatic and germinal, gametic and zygotic, chromosomal and genetic, micro and macro, biochemical, lethal, dominant and recessive, silent and neutral, spontaneous and induced. We first go to somatic and germinal mutations. Somatic mutations occur in the non-reproductive cells or the somatic cells, whereas germinal mutations, they occur in the germ cells, that is the spermatogenic cells or the oogonial cells or the sperms or the ova. So they occur in the germ cells or the gametic cells. And so also the somatic mutations are non-heritable. They will not be transferred to the next generation, whereas the germinal mutations are transmissible to the next generation. These somatic variations, they cannot change the whole organism, but they will produce cancers, chimeras, etc. Most of the cancers are somatic mutations. Then chimera means in an organism's body there will be two types of cells, a normal population of cells and a mutated population of cells. That is what is called as a chimera. And because of this, because of their non-transmissibility to the next generation, they have no evolutionary significance. Whereas the germinal mutations are transmissible to the subsequent generations and they form the raw material for speciation and evolution. So we will go to some of the examples of somatic mutations, that is most of the horticultural varieties which are of commercial value are produced through somatic variations, that is the seedless grapes, the navel oranges, the golden apples, the horticultural varieties of flowering plants, they are all produced by the somatic mutations. Eye mutations in Drosophila, where white scars are seen in the red eyes of Drosophila. So that is also an example of a somatic mutation. Another classical example of somatic mutation is the bud mutation that occurs on the leaves of certain plants, and here the bud mutation seen in a cannabis plant has been shown. So the mutation results in such a way that there will be morphological changes in the axillary buds. In the meristematic cells there will be morphological changes. The germinal mutations on the other hand are occurring in the germ cells or the gametes, and they are heritable, they are, can be transmitted from one generation to another, and they form the raw material for speciation and evolution. And the example is Ancon sheep. Next are the gametic and the zygotic mutations. Gametic mutations occur in the gametes during their formation, during gametogenesis process, and they lead to the development of mutant characteristics in all the gametes. Whereas zygotic mutations occur in the zygote. It can be during the first division or the subsequent division of the zygote. So in whichever stage it is, from the point where the mutation has occurred, all the cells derived from that particular cell will be carrying the mutation. So finally, when the organism is born as a multicellular organism, it will be a mosaic organism having normal cells as well as mutant cells. Then the chromosomal and the genetic mutations. The chromosomal mutations usually result from structural changes in chromosomes, numerical changes in chromosomes, etc. So there can be deletion on the arm of a chromosome, or there can be an addition on the arm of a chromosome. So these are examples of structural changes of chromosomes, and they can also be subjected to numerical changes. That means if a chromosome is extra or if there is a deficiency of a chromosome, they refer to numerical changes of chromosomes, and all these are chromosomal mutations, and these will lead to the formation of syndromes in organisms, and these syndromes are very commonly studied in humans. The examples are Down syndrome, Edwards syndrome, Petaus syndrome, etc. are examples of mutations that have arisen out of numerical changes of chromosomes. That is the Klinefelter syndrome. Here we can see the Turner syndrome, Edwards syndrome, Petaus syndrome, Down syndrome, etc. are all examples of chromosomal mutations. And if these mutations occur in autosomes, you call them as autosomal mutations, and if they occur in sex chromosomes, they are called as sex-linked mutations. Contrarily, the gene mutations are abnormal alterations in the chemical makeup of genes or in the molecular organization of genes. The best example of sickle cell anemia, that is, there at a particular point of the gene, a mutation occurs in such a way that the gene product formed is an altered product or a defective product. So here, that particular change is affecting only the gene and the gene product, and the subsequent changes will manifest. Okay. So that is what is called as gene mutation. Whereas in a chromosomal mutation, it affects the entire structure of the chromosome or the number of chromosomes is affected. Whereas in a genetic mutation, that particular gene will be showing the change. So it is also called as point mutation. Gene mutations are also called as point mutations. Then the micro and the macro mutations. Micro mutations, as the name indicates, produce small or unnoticeable or inconspicuous changes. So unnoticeable phenotypic effects or minor phenotypic effects are caused by mutations, then those are called as micro. And these changes may not be easily distinguishable from the normal changes, from the normal characteristics. So such mutations are called micro, whereas macro will produce strikingly strikingly evident phenotypic changes. So that is the difference. It depends upon the effect. That is how they are classified into micro and macro. Then, biochemical mutations are those which will affect the production of certain enzymes. So, if a gene mutation results in the production of an abnormal enzyme, or if a gene mutation results in non-production of an enzyme, that will affect the biochemical pathway which is catalyzed by the enzyme, and so the subsequent steps will all be affected, and that will lead to certain phenotypical changes in the organism. That is what is called as biochemical mutation. The best example is phenylketonuria, which will lead to the non-production of an enzyme. Albinism, they are all examples of biochemical mutations. Alkaptonuria, they are all affecting the production of enzymes from certain genes, and they are affecting biochemical processes occurring in our body and leading to phenotypical problems which are manifested as diseases. Now, lethal mutations, they will block. So, those changes will block the normal development and vital functioning of the cells of organisms, and they can either lead to their death before maturity, or they will not be reproductively fit. These are examples of lethal mutations. Sickle cell anemia is a lethal mutation, and most of the lethal mutations are recessive, whereas there are some lethal mutations which are dominant. The best example is that of epiloia. Epiloia is a dominant mutation which will cause abnormal skin growth, mental retardation, the formation of multiple tumors, and finally which can lead to the premature death of the human. Whereas most of the mutations are, most of the disease causing or lethal mutations are recessive in nature. So, they will manifest only in the homozygous condition. Now, going to dominant and recessive mutations. The depending upon the relation of mutant alleles with their wild forms, this classification can be explained. That is, the mutant genes may be sometimes dominant. Example is epiloia, which was discussed just before. Most of the lethal mutations are recessive. That means they will be expressed only in homozygous condition. There will be some mutant alleles which are co-dominant with their wild alleles, and some may be incompletely dominant also. So, that is what makes them dominant and recessive. Now, silent and neutral mutations. So, silent mutations are those mutations which do not produce any abnormal alteration in the gene product. They will not produce any phenotypical change. The gene has undergone a change, but it is not expressed in the phenotype. So, here in this example, we can see that there a change has occurred, a mutable change has occurred, where the change is A is mutated to G. So, here instead of A, it has been mutated to G. So, these all act as codons, and GAA has now become GAG. But both GAA and GAG code for the same amino acid, that is glutamic acid. So, there will be no abnormality in the protein product form. So, this is a particular mutation which has led to no phenotypical change. Such a mutation is called as a silent one, and usually they occur at the third base of a codon, and because of that, there are many codons which will code for the same amino acid. So, if it is usually affecting the third base of a codon, those mutations remain silent. Not always, but those mutations will remain silent. And these mutations can accumulate in organisms, and finally they will lead to polymorphism. That means they can even change into an allele finally. So, these are called as silent mutations. Now, the neutral mutation. So, here you can see this condition is called heterochromia iridum, in which the eye is having two different colors. It's a neutral mutation. It occurs in many animal species, but it is causing neither an advantage or a disadvantage to the organism. It is not having any effect on its survival value. Another example is red hair in humans. This is also an example of a neutral mutation, which is not having a selective advantage or a disadvantage. Such mutations are called as neutral. That is, the phenotypic change will be expressed, but that phenotypic change will neither be having an advantage or a disadvantage. And the last category of mutations are the spontaneous and the induced mutations. Spontaneous mutations are natural, but they occur in low frequency without any definite cause. It's a random process. Whereas induced mutations are man-made. They are induced by the application of certain agents. The agents may be physical, chemical, or biological. So, the production of mutations by artificial means is called as mutagenesis. So, that is what makes spontaneous and induced mutations different.